From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Clinical Reviews, interviews and ideas about innovations in medicine, science, and clinical practice.
Hello, and welcome to our listeners around the world. You're listening to JAMA Clinical Reviews. Thanks for joining us. I'm Dr. Kristin Walter, Deputy Editor at JAMA, and I'm joined today by Dr. Juan Carlos Cardet, who is an Associate Professor in the Division of Allergy and Immunology at the University of South Florida in Tampa, Florida. Today, we will be discussing a JAMA Insights article that he co-authored with Dr. Sergio Chiarella and Dr. Michelle Hernandez, titled Management of Severe Refractory Asthma. This article was published online in JAMA on October 1st. Dr. Cardet, thank you so much for joining us on this podcast.
Thank you so much for having me, Dr. Walter. It's a privilege and an honor to be here.
So your article states that asthma is the most common chronic airway disease worldwide, and it is associated with approximately 3,624 deaths annually in the U.S. and approximately 365,000 deaths worldwide. It also discusses how exacerbations in patients with severe refractory asthma are associated with higher mortality rates than in those with more mild forms of asthma. So to start out, can you define severe refractory asthma?
So severe refractory asthma, and this is definitions put together by task forces from professional societies and recapitulated in the Global Initiative for Asthma, is asthma that remains uncontrolled despite treatment with high-dose inhaled corticosteroids as controller therapy, plus at least a second controller, such as a long-acting beta agonist, and that those symptoms are not due to, for example, incorrect inhaler technique use or non-adherence to controller therapy, or because of a comorbid condition of asthma or an asthma mimicker. And there are several contributory comorbid conditions in asthma that can impact a disease control. So after conditions such as a gastroesophageal reflux disease, nasal polyps, chronic rhinosinusitis, vocal cord dysfunction, and others, after those have been attended to and controlled, if asthma symptoms remain, then we call that severe refractory asthma.
And what percentage of patients with asthma have severe refractory asthma?
This is thought to be a small subset. Estimates go between 1% and 5%.
And your article also discusses how type 2 or TH2 high asthma is the most common subtype of severe refractory asthma. Can you describe what T2 high asthma is?
Sure. Type 2 asthma is an inflammatory response that is mediated by the canonical cytokines, interleukins 4, 5, and 13. There's others, but at least those three. And these orchestrate an inflammatory response with, for example, type 2 T helper cells and type 2 innate lymphoid cells, among many others, that result in the stereotypical features of asthma. And in terms of how to detect type 2 high asthma, the main biomarkers that we have in clinical practice include blood eosinophils that may be available through a complete blood count with differential or with a test that is often available in specialist clinics or sometimes in primary care practices as well, which is fractional exhaled nitric oxide.
And what type of testing should patients with severe refractory asthma undergo?
So those biomarkers are important because they inform not only risk for future exacerbations, but also responsiveness not only to inhaled corticosteroids, but other important therapies that are relevant and useful for the treatment of severe refractory asthma, such as biologics. So blood eosinophils, and also FVNO. But in addition to that, every patient with severe refractory asthma should get full pulmonary function tests. These should include FEV1, FVC, and that ratio, bronchodilator response, and also total lung capacity and DLCO to distinguish asthma from other pulmonary diseases. CT scans, imaging are also helpful to distinguish asthma from other pulmonary processes. Additional collaboration and workup should be conducted in a multidisciplinary fashion. For example, which is often happens as a comorbid condition of severe refractory asthma, a laryngeal disorder or a vocal cord dysfunction, then an ENT surgeon can be very helpful by doing a laryngoscopy to evaluate for those. Nasal polyps are often a very powerful biomarker of a disease course and a risk factor for severe exacerbations. And also an ENT can evaluate for that with a rhinoscopy. And also obtaining a skin test for environmental aeroallergens, which can help identify important triggers for asthma and also help guide avoidance strategies for patients to avoid those triggers. And potentially, if the asthma becomes better controlled, allergen immunotherapy, which can also change the disease course.
And what are some recommended non-pharmacologic treatment strategies for patients with severe refractory asthma?
So, for example, there's perennial allergens, which have to do with indoor exposures, for example, dust mites. The last recommendations from the American Asthma Guidelines, which came out in December 2020, they actually recommend for multimodal intervention strategies that deal with indoor allergens. So, for example, using impermeable covers for pillows and for mattresses, and potentially using acaricidal, so agents that kill dust mites themselves, and washing bed sheets in hot water, removing carpets from the house. All those strategies reduce the exposure to dust mites. Also, very important allergens and triggers for asthma include pets, also pests, and for example, rodents and cockroaches. In those cases, it's very hard to make patients get rid of pets. That almost never happens. But if the exposure to pet dander can be reduced, it often has a very beneficial effect on patients. But if there's a problem with pests in the house, then calling in an exterminator and using remediation methods, it's helpful for asthma control.
And which medications are considered first line for all patients with severe refractory asthma?
The cornerstone of therapy for all patients with any severity of asthma, including severe refractory asthma, is inhaled corticosteroids. So for the definition of severe refractory asthma, now we're talking about high dose inhaled corticosteroids. And a strategy that has now been adopted, at least for the global initiative for asthma, so the International Report for Asthma, is the supplementation of inhaled corticosteroids as needed. So supplementing with inhaled corticosteroids for the rescue use. The paradigm for decades has been that controller therapy include inhaled corticosteroids, but that rescue therapy be exclusively done with a bronchodilator. For example, the most common one is albuterol, a beta-2 agonist. Now the recommendation is that the acute rescue bronchodilator be supplemented in some form with an inhaled corticosteroid. And that has been shown in robust, high-quality data to reduce exacerbations, regardless of the severity of the population.
And when should biologics be considered for treatment of patients with severe refractory asthma?
Typically, the indication is for patients who have exacerbation-prone asthma, and that's subject to debate, but usually it's defined as 2 or more exacerbations per year. And there's exceptions to that. For example, a patient who has had a severe asthma attack that's near fatal, perhaps a hospitalization, perhaps a mechanical ventilation because of respiratory failure during that asthma exacerbation, or other high-risk factors, for example, or if the patient is dependent on daily maintenance oral corticosteroids. So as a strategy to avoid all the systemic adverse effects that come from such a therapy, it's an indication to initiate asthma biologic therapy.
And how many biologics are approved by the U.S. FDA for moderate to severe asthma in children and adults?
There are 6 clinically available FDA-approved biologics for asthma.
The table in your Insights article provides information about these biologics, including their mechanisms of action, dosing, biomarker eligibility criteria, and potential adverse effects. All of these medications are administered subcutaneously every 2 weeks, except for one, which is given IV. Can you describe the effects of these biologics on clinical outcomes such as asthma exacerbations and hospitalizations for asthma?
So in general, and this is condensing a body of literature on biologics, right? But in general, it is thought that most biologics reduce asthma exacerbation rates by about 50%, between 48 and 50%. There is a similar reduction in hospitalizations, but keep in mind that there are many more asthma exacerbations as a population and per patient than there are hospitalizations. So perhaps it's between 50 and 60% the reduction in hospitalizations that happen with asthma biologics. Some of them produce significant benefits in lung function and FEV1 improvement, and some of them have improvements in asthma control. And we capture that using, for example, the asthma control test or asthma control questionnaire. But the effects on lung function and asthma control, asthma daily asthma symptom score, seem to be less, more modest in comparison to the reductions in asthma attacks that we get from biologics.
And are there currently any studies that provide a direct comparison of the efficacy of these different biologics?
No, unfortunately, it's never been a head-to-head comparison between a biologic. Like, there's been in other disease states, but not for asthma. There's been many network meta-analyses making different statistical assumptions to be able to compare these two biologics, but the data, it seems contradictory. It depends on the investigator group and the methods used.
Your article also discusses that many patients in the U.S. with severe refractory asthma are treated exclusively by primary care clinicians. When would you recommend that these patients be referred to an allergist or pulmonary specialist, asthma specialist?
I think patients who have recurrent exacerbations, patients who have ongoing untreated comorbidities, or perhaps where the diagnosis is unclear, perhaps when they're are suggested features of asthma subsets like aspirin exacerbated respiratory disease or ABPA, perhaps ongoing smoking or use of vapes or cannabis or other serious risk factors for asthma, I think a referral and collaboration between specialties goes a long way in improving the health of our patients.
Before closing, is there anything we didn't discuss in this podcast that you'd like to mention?
I think it's such an exciting time to be both a clinician that takes care of people with asthma, but also a patient, because these biologics that we've mentioned have revolutionized the treatment of asthma. The pipeline in asthma is so robust. There's so many different mechanisms of action and targets, not only in drug targets, but also the delivery method and also the duration of effect. So now these monoclonal antibodies can also be manipulated to stay in the system for 6 months and provide some level of coverage for that duration. Those will be clinically available very soon. But also inhaled biologics and other mechanisms of action, it's an exciting time to be in this field. But that being said, if I'm not mistaken, it was one of the initial reasons that we got invited to write this article was based on Tara Carr's. She's a physician scientist from Arizona. She had this article, a large claims-based database study that showed that even when patients have an asthma attack, a serious asthma attack, about half of them in this country, a year goes by, they have not been seen by a specialist. And there's many different reasons why most patients with uncontrolled asthma in the country are not being seen by specialists. But there is this big divide. There is so many advances in our understanding of the pathobiology of asthma. But on the other hand, most of the patients who need it the most, they never get to see the specialist for mostly because of socioeconomic or insurance or many other barriers.
Thank you so much for sharing your thoughts with us about this interesting and very important topic. I'm Dr. Kristin Walter, and I've been speaking with Dr. Juan Carlos Cardet from the University of South Florida Division of Allergy and Immunology. You can find a link to this article in this episode's description. This episode was produced by Daniel Musisi at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com or search for JAMA Network wherever you get your podcasts. Thanks for listening.
This content is protected by copyright by the American Medical Association with all rights reserved, including those for text and data mining, AI training, and similar technologies.